Gabriel de Lalave, you'll speak about geometric and numerical approaches to
AI. Okay, thank you very much. It's a real pleasure to be here, as usual. So this is a very generic title, and so because I mean there are many approaches, etc., and there are different contexts, and so what I will be talking about today is two contexts which are kind of new. Which I mean, this is progress. One is conformally symplectic systems, right? Which this is done in work with Renato Calleja and Alessandra Celletti. And the other one is something which is called sometimes non-twist tori or non-twist. I mean, non-twist mappings is a very bad name because it's a negative and so on, but it's non-twist tori. It's a more proper name. So you will see the definitions a little bit later. That's fine. Great. Oh, lots of people. Great. So anyhow, so this is the story, and I will be reporting on work in which I have not been involved, but it's also done by, it's very pretty work, by Renato Calleja and Alessandra Celletti alone, and by Renato Calleja and Jordi Luis Figueras later. So that's the story. And so the main guiding idea is that what we want is to, we try to do, I mean, this is going to be very general at the beginning, like what are, so we want to sort of do some methods which actually are very good both for numerics and for the geometry, etc., right? And these are the applications, etc. So basically what you try to do is you try to use a parametrization. You try to find a parametrization, so you don't try to do changes of variables, and the reason is because changes of variables are very bad for numerics and so on, right? So I mean, you want to do things with, but you want that the equations are solvable. So there is this phenomenon called automatic reducibility, and also I mentioned that the format of the theorems is a posteriori saying that if you have an approximate solution, then you have a true solution nearby, provided that of course there are some non-degeneracy conditions so that you can apply an implicit function theorem. So these are the context, etc., and then I will try to mention, as I mentioned, the some of the numerical work is done. I was not involved in that, but that's the applications that we have in mind. Okay. Oh, you will see it in a minute. You will see it in a minute. Thank you. So basically, you don't want. But let me tell you. So what you, if you are trying to look for an invariant object, then you find a system of coordinates that gives you the object, some embedding that gives you the object. You don't want to find a change of variables that reduces the in the ambient space that puts the object into flat. It's a little bit different, so I don't want to be working with the ambient space. I want to be working just with the function itself. But I mean, thank you for asking questions. I mean, because I mean, that's the okay. So, so this is what is a quasi-periodic orbit, etc. And then we have, I already noticed the first typo, etc. So this is a quasi-periodic orbit, which is an orbit that is given in a Fourier series and so on. And the Fourier series is given there, and then there should be, so this is the mapping that goes from TD to RN, and then this is given by just the Fourier expansion, and then when you evaluate it in N omega, then you obtain the point, right? So this is some things that that obtain the orbits, right? And I mean, and the answering the question of Professor Matter, the fact is that D can be very different from N. In general, it's very much smaller, and so on, and as we will mention later, then dealing with functions with less variables is very good for the numerics.
Don't you want the xn's, don't you want any Fourier coefficients there?
Oh yes, I want Fourier coefficients, sorry, that's a very important typo. Thank you. Thank you, and then the k and theta, then it's also Fourier coefficients. For some reason I was putting something that didn't show up in there, okay. Very good, thank you. So the audience is more careful than I am, good. So, and then the K satisfies this invariance equation, of course, because, I mean, when you hit it with K, then the internal clock goes by omega, and I denote the notation by the T omega. So this is going to be the thing that we are going to be looking at most of the time, which is just an invariance equation. It's a functional equation, so they give you F, and they give you omega, and then you have to find the K, right? And of course, they give you also the dimensions, right? The dimensions, of course, are specified also, right? And then, of course, this is kind of hopeless in general, but if you have some geometry, then you can do quite good progress, etc., both in the numerics and in the theorem. So let me just see what is the story. So this is the geometric interpretation. So the way that one often looks like it is you have the, whatever it is, the perfect image of the torus, I mean, in the Platonic universe, etc., and then you find the embedding, okay? And the embedding has to be such that it intertwines the rotation. This is what in ergodic theory people call factors or something like that, right? So this is the story. So you have the K that sends this beautiful torus abstract into the real space, and then the map F moves it in such a way that it mirrors the daisy rotations. So, I mean, of course, in applications, very often one has to deal with vector fields, but I mean, I'm not going to be dealing with vector fields because the pictures are prettier in maps and so on, but then when in the papers everything is done for vector fields also. Okay, so let me just tell you that, of course, this is something that has been studied in many cases, so because there have been people computing invariant manifolds, and the manifolds that you can prove generalize the stable and unstable manifolds. You can even do slow invariant manifolds, which is something interesting to people sometimes, because this is what the renormalization group people call the beta functions. So you can make sense of that. And anyhow, so the basic idea is that you have the invariance equation, right? I mean, this is kind of the outline of the things. So you will derive a Newton method to study this equation, and then this Newton method will require geometric properties that has cancellations, because there are some bad terms and so on. But if you have geometry, the good things is that lots of the bad terms drop out like flies and so on, and then this leads both to theorems and to fast numerical algorithms, and exactly the same calculations, they require something like that. Now, there are several cases, that, especially in the very non-degenerate, in very degenerate cases that I will be discussing today, there will be free parameters, and then you will have to adjust the parameters, etc., but then this is going to be easy. This is going to be like a finite dimensional implicit function theorem or something like that. And of course, this is the thing that will appear in the non-twist, is that you will be, if you have enough parameters, then you can get that the tori satisfies several interesting conditions about how the neighborhoods look like, etc. So you can also start to study what are the jets around them, and then I will, and this is useful for several people. Anyhow. So this is kind of mentioning that this story that I was discussing before is that we are manipulating functions of as many variables as possible, because I mean, if you are trying to do numerics, the number of variables that you are using is the main killer, right? I mean, this is what people call the curse of dimension. I mean, if you are dealing with functions of d dimensions, then roughly speaking, you require something that grows exponentially with the dimension. So working with one-dimensional functions rather than two-dimensional functions is much, much better. And with two rather than four, then it's very, very good, right? So if you, so you don't want to do all these things. Now, as you will see, the algorithms are going to be very fast and so on. So basically, you require very little storage and n log n operations. And you know, these things nowadays can run in laptops. Very, I mean, so all the calculations that I have discussed are whatever. And now, the important thing that I also want to mention is that the main theorem that we will give is one of these, the thing that the numerical analysts call a posteriori theorems, that basically is something that if you have an approximate solution, you give some verifiable conditions, and then you conclude that there is a true solution. And you don't need to justify how you produce the approximate solution. The approximate solution could be done because you dream it at night, or because you have done some perturbative expansions which are totally unjustified, or it could be because you have done numerics and so on, and you believe that your computer is doing okay. So basically, so this is something which is it's very standard in numerical analysis. So this is what people call a posteriori theorems. So when you try to sort of solve a functional equation, so this typically is a functional equation in some space. So here is more or less the theorems. Of course, you need some hypothesis. This doesn't happen for every f. I mean, you require some hypothesis in f, which I mean, this is not a theorem. This is just an skeleton more or less telling you what it is. So there are going to be some conditions. So what you have is you have an approximate solution. And an approximate solution is something that solves the invariance equation up to a very small error in some norm, right? Then you have also several condition numbers that you can compute, right? So then you have several condition numbers, and then you need to assume that the error is sufficiently small depending on the condition numbers, right? That's the language in numerical analysis. And then you conclude that there exists a true solution and that the true solution is close to the approximate solution. And of course, since this will be KAM, I notice that there is a norm 1 and over here there is a norm 2, right? So typically the conclusions are in a weaker norm, right? And of course, well, these are some computable conditions that people try to look at, more or less that there is like an approximate inverse or something like that, right? So you will see in a minute exactly what these condition numbers are. So this is what, for example, in numerical analysis in linear algebra, this is some crude approximation of the norm of the inverse of a matrix, right? And if you can find a solution and the... Sorry? Right, because there are several condition numbers, right? So there is not just one number, there are many numbers that you may need to compute, okay? So you may need to compute several condition numbers that allow you to see what are true. I mean, typically this is going to be an upper bound on the twist condition, but the important thing is that you can compute them in the approximate solution, right? Or on the problem. So yeah, so you have to do several. So the main effort is that you produce an approximate solution, and then you have to compute something onto it to check that the thing is not completely crazy, right? I mean, producing approximate solutions is relatively easy because, I mean, once you start putting a computer working, then it produces an approximate solution or it goes in flames. But you need to check that the thing is sort of not too oscillating and not too crazy or something like that, okay? I mean, so then this is the story, right? So an approximate solution and then some computable conditions that allow you to conclude that this approximate condition is not totally crazy, okay? So that's the, you will see some examples. I mean, I thought that this is like whatever it is. Now, these theorems, I mean, it is obviously how we are going to prove them, is that you describe an iterative method and then you give conditions that ensures that it converges. And that, roughly speaking, this is something that these condition numbers are things that tell you that you can get things started, etc. And of course, the things that we will use here is Newton's method and, of course, Nash-Monser methods because they are more efficient numerically and they allow to go close to breakdown because that's one of the things that we want to play, etc. Now, so here is more or less the concrete applications that we have in mind. So these are like conformally symplectic systems, which are kind of interesting things that have not been studied so much from the KAM point of view. There are some papers I should mention of Kerki and Celletti, but we did a little bit. So these are systems that have the property you have a symplectic form, and what they do is that they map it into a multiple of itself with a number, etc. So these appear in several problems, etc. So whenever you have a mechanical problem that has a friction which is proportional to the velocity, then you get a conformally symplectic system, right? So this is one application. Another application is that when you take, so this is something which is actually very, very popular now in mathematics or in economics or in control theory or in many of these areas of variational calculus. So basically you have a Lagrangian and you discount it with an interest, right? So this is the typical things that happen if you want to modify what they call the present value of something, right? So you try to do something, and then you modify the choices so that you optimize what is the present value of the trajectory. So if L satisfies the condition, then these UIs they can be transformed into a conformally symplectic system. You get an extra term that comes when you take derivatives of the I, and then this gives you the conformally symplectic system. So all these things that well, this is, for example, the problem that happens when you have a body that has a certain shape, and it's subject to rotating around a planet, and it has tides, which is a friction. So this is one of the things that people have been looking at. Please. Exactly. So when the moon is whatever, and that's one of the reasons. I mean, that's what people, I mean, there is all this fantastic phenomenon that the motion of rotation around the moon towards around itself and the motion around the Earth, they are locked into a resonant one-to-one, right? And why is it that? So people have been writing models about that. And there are many other planets and satellites that are locked into resonances. For example, Mercury is very close into 3 to 2. And so on. I mean, so there are many of these things that are, I mean, and people want to understand why this is the case.
Did all form the conformally symplectic systems?
People have been looking at, I mean, they are models, so people can write models for these things and so on, and the models can be very simplified, but these are very popular models for these things in which the friction is proportional to the flux. That's right. And this is one model that is. I mean, this would be a discussion for the physicists, but I mean, from the mathematics, they give you the models and so on, and this is one of the sources. I mean, they can be, but the friction proportional to the velocity is a very good model for many things. I mean, and the reason is, of course, that Alessandra wrote several papers on this. So let me try to mention the theorem, etc., and then just to give you a flavor, I don't want to explain too much time in technicalities. But this is just to tell you what is the story. I mean, and all of these things are variants, etc. So typically, you try to prove a theorem with you need these norms and so on. And these are very standard norms that people use in all these KAM theorems since Moser and so on. You take the supremum in bands and so on, and then the smoothing is giving bands. Or you can do things. And now I remember to put the Fourier coefficients and so on. So these are the Sobolev norms, right? So the Sobolev norms are also very good and so on. And one of the advantages of Sobolev norms compared to others is that they are very computable. So if you are working with Fourier series and so on, as I will discuss later. So let me tell you more or less what is. And then, of course, you also need some assumptions of the things which go into the things that I was putting in red, etc. So you need that the frequency of motion is, and there is another mistake, this should be D, the dimension, the frequency is diophantine, so this is one of the assumptions that we will need. So let me just try to tell you what is the main theorem, and I will just sort of highlight more or less what are the hypotheses. Some of them are very obvious. I mean, you need omegas, which is frequency, and you have a family of conformally symplectic mappings with respect to one symplectic form, right? And then this is more or less what I was answering a little bit the Tom's question. So you assume one approximate solution, etc., and then you sort of assume that there is one determinant, which I will, I wrote it over here a little bit later. I mean, all of this is written, but the point that I want to make is that this is an explicit expression that it's algebraic. I mean, and I wrote it down a little bit later on in the paper, etc. But it's a little bit ugly. But this is just a finite dimensional metric. So this is so you perform. It's a recipe, very easy to implement. You take derivatives of the invariance equation. You put them together into certain forms and so on. and it takes you maybe like a couple hundred lines to program them. It's not terrible. And then you check that this determinant is not zero. And that's it. So that's so this is a determinant which is finite dimensional. So you take several expressions, and then you determine it, etc. So in the analytic case, you need a few extra other. So there are two. I mean, I want to prove the theorem both in two cases. One in the Sobolev case, and the other is in the analytic case. And I will explain you why. The reason is, so in the Sobolev case, then you need that the things are mapped inside of the domain and so on, and this is another condition number, that when you map in the domain, you are not very close to the domain where the function is defined, right? Because otherwise, then this would be a disaster, you're going to be modifying, etc. And then this is the approximate solution, that the sense in which it's approximate solution. So the condition numbers depend on, there is this constant that depends on the twist, etc., the Fontich properties and so on, and then the analyticity properties. So that's, it's a very explicit condition that you can put very quickly and so on, and it depends on this magic matrix that I have not explained what it is. Then the sizes of the derivatives, and then the how far you are from missing the analyticity conditions, right? So there are three or four condition numbers, and that's the thing. So one is the analyticity domain, one is this magic geometric constant, and the other is these things over here. And if you have some condition like this, then you conclude that this one satisfies, and then you know that there is one solution which is close. And in the Sobolev case, it's exactly the same. Modulo one of these technicalities that you lose a lot of derivatives, since Professor Sender is here, I mentioned that if you use these methods, then double smoothing is not possible, and you have to use the single smoothing method, which loses lots of derivatives. And the reason is because if you have problems that have a geometric structure, smoothing them and approximating them by things with the same geometric structure is a little bit cumbersome, but that's a defect of the method, but I mention it. So anyhow, so that's the same over here. So the argument, as you will see, then it also leads to local uniqueness, existence of Lindstedt series, and so on. And for our purposes, there are several interesting results for us. That one of them I want to mention is that, of course, there is a bootstrap of regularity. If you have an analytic map, all solutions with high enough Sobolev regularity are analytic, and the reason is very simple. If you truncate the Fourier series, and the Fourier series is enough, regular enough, then this is an approximate solution in the analytic sense, and so on, and then you can provide and so on with the uniqueness, and you're happy. A smooth dependence on parameters, it's also automatic for all these theorems, because you can guess the Lindstedt series, so you can make a guess, something that satisfies the equation to a high error. Then, since you know that you have an a posteriori theorem, then you know that the true solution is close to the things that satisfy the small error, so the Lindstedt series is actually justified automatically. And then the study of the limit, etc. So also the thing that I want to discuss a little bit more is that this gives you an analytic numerical algorithm. So you have an approximate solution, you change the parameters a little bit, and that's the story. And also this also gives you something which, of course, we were discussing a lot when I was a graduate student just on the other side of town. This gives you a criterion for the breakdown of analytic circles. And you can see that because of all these things over here, the only way that analytic circles can break down is either if one of these conditions break down, right, or because of the Sobolev norms blow up. So that's the criterion and so on. And it's very reliable. You don't need to do any difficult things like approximating by periodic orbits like John Green was doing or things like that. So that's a very.
Can you also do that for a linear breakdown of analytic circles with a certain rotation number?
That's correct, yes.
Now, suppose I want to do that in higher dimensions, I look for a torus with a certain rotation number.
That's correct, yes. Yes.
For the breakdown of that.
Yeah, I mean, all these theorems, etc., all these theorems are true in any number of dimensions. All these theorems are true in any number of dimensions. And the corollary is the same. Of course, the numerics. I mean, actually, we are doing things now in two dimensions, and I can. The results are a little bit preliminary, but I mean, I'll just discuss them later.
I mean, so your breakdown means that you no longer have a proof.
Exactly. No. That it doesn't exist. It doesn't exist. So I. That's correct. So basically, the thing that happens is the following: these methods continue the tori till it ceases to exist. So these methods, if you do the proper continuation method, right, so they reach to the boundary of existence. And you can see that if the Sobolev norm blows up, then there cannot be any analytic circle. That's correct. That certainly can happen. But these things, it's like all these continuation methods, I mean, they have no, I mean, what I am saying is that these continuation methods don't have any hidden failure, etc. So when the methods stop to work is because the thing ceases to exist. So, I mean, of course, I mean, in numerical methods, etc., then it means I cannot deal with more than a million Fourier coefficients, and the Fourier coefficients are going to be computed only with 15 figures, etc. That's something which I have not concluded. But modulo the numerical errors, this can go all the way to the boundary of existence.
So can you prove something? Can you actually prove it for the standard map, for example, in the golden mean, that there's a last invariant curve? So the picture people have was that there's an invariant curve up to
that's correct.
Beyond that.
And not beyond that.
But,
well,
but I mean, this is what they show numerically. But
yes.
Consistent with, say, it suddenly
reappearing again. Well, I wrote a paper about all this with, so there are all these other arguments about the, for the standard map, there is also these other techniques of renormalization group, etc., and the abstraction criterion of Olvera and Simon. And what we prove is the following. I mean, it's a conditional theorem, but if the renormalization group satisfies one condition, which we have not checked except numerically, but I mean, I'm willing to bet, I mean, maybe not the house, but I mean, certainly a good dinner or something. And I mean, and we all drum, but we all run in airplanes that have been checked less carefully, right? I mean, that's the story and so on. But there is one condition in the renormalization group, and if the renormalization group verifies this condition, then that happens. That's exactly true. So this is something which is a very interesting project if somebody has the energy, but we give one condition. So there is one operator in infinite dimensionals and spaces, etc., and then you have to do some computations on it. And if these computations happen to be smaller than one, then this phenomenon that Professor Matter was mentioning is true. So that's a theorem. And of course, the fact that this number is smaller than one is not proved. But
so what exactly again was the phenomenon?
That you have a domain of existence which is an interval in this family, which is the standard map. This is one particular example.
I'm studied very intensely, and in the example, supposedly it's called standard example.
Yes.
It's the golden mean circle. And supposedly there's a number, except that for value of the parameter less than the number, there's an invariant circle. For parameter value of values of the parameter greater than the number, there's no invariant circle.
Yes.
Verified numerically, but it's consistent with the circles disappearing and reappearing in a very small region of that.
Exactly.
A simpler question would be just if you just know that beyond, I don't know what is the number, like 0.97 or whatever it is, that you don't have a circle.
That's correct.
But that, you could just show that. There are easy ways to show that.
Yes. Well,
depending on how close to the.
Exactly.
Well,
this is like a digression. I was coming from the other side, but I was coming from the KM side, but of course I have been obsessed with problems like this for a long time, and I have been also looking for
the other side, but I mean, you know, but I cannot explain both at the same time. But I'm very glad that people ask the question. So I mean that's certainly true. But what Tom is saying is that from the others, I mean, here there is one theorem that tells you that the numerical method is going to converge, but then you don't know if, I mean, I am going to give up with 10 to the minus 8 or something like that, right? And I still have, but then the question is what happens in this 10 to the minus 8 or 10 to the minus 20 and so on. So, okay, so that part of the thing is not known, and it could in principle be, I mean, actually the calculations become very difficult because, I mean, as the people here know, there are of course the Aubrey matter sets, and the Aubrey matter sets have very small gaps, and how do you distinguish the Aubrey matter sets? Depending on the numerics that you do, you have to be very, very careful to distinguish the the Aubrey matter sets from the true tori, right? If the parameters is very small and so on, because I mean, if you use things like splines and so on, the gaps are like 10 to the minus 5 or something, and then this is a disaster. But on the other hand, with Fourier series, then you can be sure that if you have a small residual, then you will do it. I mean, that's the good thing about the method. Please. Well, for twist mappings, of course, it's close, right? Because yeah, you can pass to the limit. Yes. Yeah, well,
the circuits disappear and reappear. At least, I mean, there's one paper on it. I can't remember the name of the author, but.
Yeah, well, it was.
And numerically, showed
some bullet, you remember that?
Do you remember the name?
Bullet. Sean Bullet, yeah.
Sean Bullet. He showed the circles. Numerically, they disappear.
No, I mean, it's very easy to construct examples where they appear and disappear, but anyhow, that's another story. All right, so let's see, and whatever. So let me just try to tell you what is the idea of the proof, and then you will see where the geometry comes in and so on, and where is the thing over here. So you start with a map that looks like the, oh, sorry. So you start with the equation, which is, I mean, this is the equation that we were studying. Oh, what happened? All right, I clicked on something. Okay, so this is the equation we start with, right? And again, I just wrote it over here, and I remind you that the unknowns are the parameters lambda and k, right? So then when you try to do that, then of course the Newton method, let me just not justify it too much, but you modify k into k plus delta, right? And then you do it in such a way that the linear approximation kills the error, and then these are the changes. So you change you change the lambda by this little delta, and then you change the k into k plus delta, and this is the equation that you get, and this is an ugly equation because you don't know how to deal with it, because there is this factor here which messes you up and so on, right? So this is an equation which you don't know what to do. But the key is that you can find a good frame of reference that makes this equation to look very nice. So let me take derivatives of the initial approximation. So if you take derivatives of the Alishian approximation, you get that for all practical purposes, the vectors that come into the K, when you multiply them, they just get translated, right? I mean, and this is like an error term, etc. Now, let me look at the thing that happens when you, so this is the picture, and this has formulas, etc. So here is the decay, right? And then what you do is that you form the symplectic conjugate, right? Which, I mean, here I depicted it in two dimensions as the orthogonal and so on. So when you hit it by the derivative of the map, then this is the image of the derivative of the map. Here is the normal again, normalized to area one. Well, what do you know about this little rectangle here? What you know about this little rectangle is that the area is lambda times the area of the original one, right? So, and if the area is the same as the original one, then the height has to be lambda, right? So what you have discovered, I mean, what you have discovered by this little argument is that if you take a frame of reference in which you take the derivative of the map and then the normal, right, then it has a then the map has a structure like this. Okay, in higher dimensions, the argument is not just a picture; it's a calculation, and you have to use that the invariant tori are Lagrangian, right? Which, of course, you know that, and so on, or approximately Lagrangian, but that's okay. So, in higher dimensions, I mean, I'm not going to give you the algebra because it's not too difficult. But I mean, basically, what you mean is that if you take the symplectic conjugate, they're orthogonal, and then you can play the same argument, etc. So there are these matrices over here. And now you make this change of variables, which is that you express delta in the coordinates over here, right, with m, and then this is what happens. So the derivative m, etc., etc. So this is just substituting the Newton equation. I just make this change of variables, but now you realize that this term df composed with km then just becomes precisely this, right? That's the beauty of the thing, and then. Well, then you do two things. One is that this term is second order, right? This term is second order, and this term is second order, and you ignore it. And then this m composed tw minus 1 goes to the other side. So this was one of the condition numbers that I was putting over here, which was a little bit messed up, is that you can kill the terms that appear there and so on, and that you can choose the parameters in such a way that this thing happens, right? So that's all the things that there is to it, and so on. And so in two dimensions, this was. And now what you obtain is that you obtain one equation, which is of the form. Then you derive an equation, which is w minus w composed 2 omega equals something and so on, which is the equations that you know how to solve in KM theorem, because you can use Fourier analysis. They are just diagonal equations with constant coefficients. So this change of variables using the geometry reduces it to to constant coefficients, right? And I point out that the method is completely, how should I say, it's very explicit, so everything is very explicit. So so anyhow, so this is the good thing, and by the way, I mean, I should mention that in two dimensions this was done by Rusman, but this works also in higher dimensions if you use a little bit of symplectic geometry. And then you get uniqueness very quickly because from these theorems, because I mean, if you get to normalize the equation somehow, because there are some free parameters, then you discover that applying this procedure, then you obtain that. I mean, if you have two solutions, their difference satisfies the error with just the Taylor expansion. The derivative is then the Taylor expansion over here, and then you have a thing in there. And now the only thing that you need to do is to use Hadamard's three-circle theorem, and then you discover that if this number is smaller than 1, then this number has to be 0. So this is a one-line proof of uniqueness. So let me tell you what the implementation, some remarks about the numerics, and I will tell some of the operations. So the whole procedure, if you start from K and lambda to compute the corrections, it involves several things. It involves shifting the functions, composing, adding and subtracting, and computing derivatives and inverting matrices, and, well, this would be in blue, solving difference equations, right? Okay, now the interesting thing is that these operations are all of them are order n, if you have an order n either in Fourier space or in discretization space, if you or in the discrete space. Some of them, like adding functions or subtracting functions, are order n in both, right? But if you have to compose a function with another, the parametrization with a function, and you have it discretized in a set of grids, then you just have to evaluate in the set of grids. For computing a derivative, then you have to go through the Fourier coefficients, multiply them by a number, so this requires order n operations, etc. So all these things can be done. So if you switch between Fourier representation and discrete representation, you can do it in n log n steps and so on, because, and actually, even from the practical point of view, this is even better than n log n, because this is one of the algorithms, the fast Fourier transform, is one of the algorithms that is most optimized in modern architectures, in modern computers. So it's not just n log n in theory. I mean, it's n log n. I mean, people really break their heads by getting it to run fast. So that's the situation. So then you have an algorithm, etc. So let me just try to explain a little bit of the things that that we discussed. So there are some numerical facts and numerical surprises, which are a little bit. So let me study this. This is one example which is similar to what people call in the spin orbit problem. So this is a very famous map. It's very similar to the standard map that Professor Matter was mentioning, except that I have this lambda here, which is the conformal factor, and I have this other extra parameter there that the astronomers call the drift or something, right? But that's a mapping. And then it has two parameters over here. So if this was not there, then this would be the standard map, right? But then I put an extra parameter because this is actually testing the boundaries of what people know in the standard map, and then you will see. Maybe this is also answering the questions that Professor Matter was asking. Okay, so this is more or less what happens, and if you do this, then you can obtain very, very confident what is the domain of existence. And I notice that, sorry, so this is for lambda equal 0.9. And this it has smooth boundaries, and this has smooth boundaries, but then over here it has jagged things over here, right? So it has. So this is the domain. So this doesn't show up. So this is the domain of parameters epsilon 1 and epsilon 2, for which you can find a golden mean invariant circle, right? Yeah. So there is an epsilon 1 over here and an epsilon 2. So epsilon is small, but I mean it should not be small in the slides, right? Thank you. In this case, epsilon is not small. So you see it arrives to this famous value like 0.97 and so on, right? But so this would be this line over here. When epsilon 2 is equal to 0, then this is the famous case over here that Green was studying and so on, right? And over here, the boundary is smooth and so on. And over here, the boundary is smooth, so that means for the people that are into this is that there is a renormalization group, and the renormalization group has a smooth invariant manifold there and so on. But over here, there is crazy stuff going on in there. And so this suggests to us that the renormalization group has like a horseshoe or something. So presumably this fact that that the torus disappears and never appears again, etc., is true in this region more or less, but then it's false over there.
So lambda 0.9, what does that mean? Does that mean I have a lot of friction or very little?
Oh, this is very little friction.
One would be?
One would be no friction whatsoever, and yes, and zero should be lots of friction. Yes, I mean because I am adjusting this parameter, this drift parameter.
Which one?
This parameter mu. So this is like an external forcing. So you have to adjust the external forcing. This is what I was telling, that mu is part of the unknowns of the game. Huh? So you have to adjust the external forcing, and then you have to adjust the initial conditions so that you get the KM curve. That's correct. And then you have to readjust the mu. So that's the way that people work. And of course, if you work in physics, etc., which is that mu is given to you, then you have your tables and so on, and then you use the inverse function theorem, and then you get the results that you want for fixed mu. That's correct. That's correct. That's correct. But if you change the mu, then the curves that appear are getting, and then you get also other crazy stuff in the middle, right?
So
people know.
Have to vary fractal if I want to, you know, have some kind of.
No, mu is a function, of course, as a function of omega. It's a little bit of a disaster because omega is only defined on Cantor sets and so on.
Yeah.
But mu as a function of epsilon 1 and epsilon 2 is smooth. If you fix omega to be a Diophantine number, so that's a smooth function. So that's one of the corollaries of the thing. So this is more or less how the thing looks like, and you see, and so on. And so there is something which I want to mention, which is that there are some surprises. After you do numerics, then there are some new mathematical things that happen. And this is something that I should have put over here. This is work of Calleja and Figueras. And so there is this loss of hyperbolicity. So when the circle, so this is something which is a sort of numerical fact, right? So the circle remains a little bit smooth, okay? So this thing that I put in blue is not proved, right? But if it is, but if it was true, then the rest follows rigorously, okay? So, and it's actually very funny what follows rigorously. So what follows rigorously is that the Lyapunov exponent in the transverse direction is equal to lambda, but the torus is breaking down. So how can a manifold lose hyperbolicity and if the Lyapunov exponent is true? Well, the only way that can happen is that the bundles collapse, right? That the stable bundle collapse with the tangent, right? So that's the only thing that can happen. And actually, there are some movies that I wanted to maybe show. So let me just say the story. So this is one of the surprises. And there are other surprises, but I mean, so let me just tell you, for example, how does the calculation look like? So this is computing the invariant circle as you are climbing into the parameters in epsilon 1 and epsilon 2 equal to 0, right? And then you get into this value and then you kill it. But the invariant bundles, right? So I just plot the angles of the invariant bundles. The one is the tangent and the other one is the stable bundle, right? So when they are collapsing, they are coming close together, and they are climbing close together, and so this is something that this is a rigorous consequence of the fact that there is a of the conjecture that there is a that the torus remains smooth till the boundary, just a little bit smooth, and the loss of hyperbolicity has to come like that. There are other surprises which I am not, which I thought I had put in the slides and so on, but is that the power that this blow up happens like a power law, and it's extremely simple power law, right? So it's a power law. So the Sobolev norms beyond a certain degree, I mean the low Sobolev norms remain bounded, but then there is a critical Sobolev norms, and all of them blow up like a power. Okay. Well, what I am saying is that if you look at this map K, maybe a it's a very crazy number, and I don't know really. So let me put over here. So you have HM, right? So this is approximately equal to 1 minus epsilon divided by epsilon critical, right? To something, let me put it over here. This is alpha M minus beta. And alpha and beta are universal numbers, independent of lambda and independent of the model in a certain range. And I mean, they're in the sense of.
But they would depend upon the fact that lambda is less than 1.
There is a very interesting thing that happens. So this alpha and beta, they are identical. So this is when lambda is less than 1, and it doesn't matter what lambda is. So, and then there are alpha, let's put over here 0 and beta 0 for lambda equal to 1. And they are different. So that's a very strange thing that happens. It doesn't. Numerically, it doesn't. Numerically, it doesn't. You see, the thing that happens is the following. Let me give you a heuristic reasoning, and then this is.
Lambda equals 0 at the moment of
breaking. That's correct. Yes. Yes. I mean, I am going to give you an argument which is not rigorous, right? I mean, and I hesitate to say it, but I mean, but, uh, But the thing is the following: if you look at the, if you are going to have universal numbers and you're going to have a general theory, then it has to be independent of lambda. Why? Because if you look at the second iterate of the map, the second iterate of the map has lambda square. So if you are going to make a statement about things that that apply to F and to F square, then they have to be independent of lambda. Of course, this doesn't mean that there are statements that apply to F and to F square, but if there are statements that apply to F and to F square, and they are halfway reasonable, like measurable in lambda or something like that, right, then they have to be independent, right? I mean, I know how to make functions that are invariant under x goes to x squared, but I mean, you know, but if they are nice, then they have to be independent, right? I mean, so this is more or less the argument, or f composed to the third power. I mean, if you put all these things over here, then the only reasonable things that you, I mean, it's not a rigorous argument, but, you know, but if you can do things for a class of functions that are close under composition, since composition raises lambda to powers, then it has to be independent. I mean, in the 80s, David Rand published a series of papers in communications in mathematical physics, which, I mean, were not completely rigorous, and but they are very interesting still. I mean, and they are not complete and so on, you know, people at the time were very happy if they could compute with 100 by 100 matrices and so on. But so we can do better now, 20 years later, but I mean, but this type of arguments people were looking at. But yeah, that's an interesting fact that was kind of discovered empirically, and I don't think, well, I had prepared quite a lot of other slides, but then maybe I'll go very quickly. So this is another type of problems, which is this business of a study of non-twist invariant circles. So basically, so I'll go very quickly and just to go to the punchlines or something. So basically, you have lots of parameters in this case, but then you want that the tori look like something like this, right? So these are mappings that appear, for example, in the neighborhood of something, and this is one of the, I will tell you where this comes from and so on, but then for reasons that so people are interested in this tori, I mean, this is a map which is certainly non-twist, right, because the torus is not a graph and so on, but then these things appear all of a sudden and so on. So if you have parameters, etc., so it has become a design goal in certain communities to find things like this, because then they separate. I mean, if you look at this, this is a caricature of what happens in one of these beam accelerators or something, that you have a core in the middle and then you have something separated, right? So you want that, so to speak, your particles stay in this beam, right? Going around Geneva for many, many times and so on, and they don't drift away, right? Anyhow, so this is the situation, and now let me give you the example. So this is one of these examples. So this is area-preserving mappings, but they violate the twist condition very badly, and they also violate in very badly way for the experts the Russman conditions, because, I mean, the set of frequencies that they cover is not open. So you put yourself in the boundary of the frequencies that, the boundary of the frequency maps that appear, and you want to sort of, but you have a little bit of freedom, I mean, and then there is this number that I put over here, carefully chosen and so on. So let me just try to sort of tell you what is the story. So when you...
What's bad about that? I didn't go back to the previous slide.
Yes, so this is this square, right? So so the derivative with respect to y at y equal to zero vanishes, and then also you cannot get the whole range of frequencies, because at zero you just get a closed interval. Right? So this is the situation. Now, when you take k equal to zero, so this is an integrable mapping, and then you find two circles, and then you find two circles again, and then eventually you find one circle. Right? So there is one way of understanding this. So if you look at the integrable mappings, then you have a frequency mapping, which is the gradient of a function, and then you want to find, and then basically you can find frequencies whenever you have things in the range of this gradient, right? And now what you do is you add parameters, etc., right? And that's basically the story. And then you can define one potential. So I'm still talking about the integrable cases, right? So you define the integrable mappings, which is these things over here. And then you can find the counter term as a function of P, and which is precisely this, right? So the thing that I am saying is that if you prescribe that you want to obtain an invariant torus with a height P, right, then you have to apply a counter term, and that this counter term is the gradient of a function. So this is the geometric structure that you obtain in integrable systems. In integrable systems, it's just a two-line calculation. But then you will see that the things are going to... So the things that I am going to conclude is that these things happen. So in particular, you have one torus is invariant if and only if it's a critical point of the potential, and the non-torus and it's a non-twist torus if and only if it's a degenerate point of the thing over here of the critical of the potential and so on. And then you can even try to be a little bit more precise, and then of course there are many, many critical points, right? And of course critical points are classified by singularity theory, right? And so, I mean, maybe I should be a little bit more careful about it. This is just running through the example from this point of view. We have the potential depending on three parameters, and then you see that at the beginning we have two, I mean, and this is the gradient of the potential, and then you see that you go from having two critical points to having one critical point. And this is just the integrable case, but calculated through the point of view of the potential. Now, the only thing that I am going to try to mention is that that's actually very quickly, is that that all this geometric structure persists even for non-integrable systems, that you can define a potential and that the frequency map, and that if you prescribe things even far away from integrable, no matter where, right, then you can define the counter terms, and the counter terms are a gradient, right? So that's the story. And then, of course, the classification given by singularity theory for the gradients of functions is going to be stable under perturbations of the model. That's the situation. So, I mean, I think I will maybe just try to go very quickly through this, but then you can formulate all this in an a posteriori method. So, but everything now has to be lifted into families. So, all these standard Newton methods that I was describing for the symplectic mappings, then you can put parameters, and then the parameters go there for free. And then the thing which is not completely obvious is that you can, well, I mean, the fact that you have a potential and all these sort of things. But the fact, here is where you have to use heavily the symplectic geometry, because, I mean, all these k's, right, all these k's are parametrizations of Lagrangian manifolds. And whenever you have parametrizations of Lagrangian manifolds, then there is all this theory about that they have a potential. And basically, if you take these potentials that were described by, by many people, starting with Weinstein and all these other people, etc., and then you take the average, then you obtain something which is invariant under changes of variables, and which actually allows you to classify the things over here, and which is stable under deformation. So that's more or less the story. And again, the thing over here, the same phenomenon happens, that you get automatic reducibility of Lagrangian manifolds, and then you can do KAM theorem for them, you can do Newton methods, but just using the fact that they are automatically, whenever you have a rotation, then you have the automatic reducibility, and then you can try to do all these things over here. So maybe I will just try to tell a little bit what are the... So this is the theorem of persistence, but it's basically what I described in words, is that if you have a singularity which is an unstable unfolding and you have enough parameters, it's enough to calculate it approximately to sort of be sure that you have it. Okay, And again, you can give explicit conditions about how close you need to have it, so that how close you need to have it, in order that you can be sure that your calculations are correct. Okay, so that's the situation. So let me give you some of the examples, right? So this is the example that we were discussing before, and I added the modifying parameter. Then you can define the primitive function, which is the function that I take the average. So the, I mean, this is something to do with the, well, maybe I'll just try to see over here. So this is the picture that I was showing before, but then it has a little bit more of things that actually go in behind and so on. And then you can scan and figure out what are the stability properties of this. So these are the two invariant circles. And then what appears over here, so here is the potential, right? And you see that you have two critical points, right? Okay, and then here is the gradient that has two zeros, right? So that's the thing over here. So now things are getting closer, but then you can see this happening in terms of singularity theory. And then when you have the two, when you have the two circles colliding, which happens at this magic value that can be computed with about six or seven figures, then you see that you have a zero over here of the gradient, and then in the potential you have an inflection point. So, and then when you keep on going, then you can still compute the potential, you can still compute everything, but then there is, it has no zeros and no invariant things. Now, so here is another example, which is a little bit more interesting, because this is the example where the non-twistor I come from nowhere, so to speak, right? But you see, if you do these calculations, which can be done very fast and parallel, etc., then you can more or less be sure that you figure out when these things are, where these things are going to appear, right? So let me just try to tell them. So here is, so for, you see, this is these things over here. So if you look at the mapping, then you don't see nothing. You see just chaos, etc. But if you compute the potential, then you see, okay, this is getting very close to being, this is having a close, this is getting close to having a zero, okay? And then sure enough, when you increase the thing like by 1%, then you discover that there is indeed one parameter value for which you can discover the existence of the things, and afterwards they start appearing. Anyhow, so I think that's the situation. I mean, and the I have the good part, the good thing is that the papers are already whatever posted, etc. So if somebody wants to discuss, I will be here till Saturday or so. So I will be more than happy to give more details or whatever. Okay, thank you.